the JFJ Conspiracy Podcast, where the shop talk is rock.
I'm Jim.
And I'm Peter Chris.
And I'm Jerry.
This is the JFJ Conspiracy Podcast, where the shop talk is rock. How are you guys doing this week?
Doing good, Pete. How
doing
are you?
Doing great, Peter.
Yeah, you know what? I can't do this. It's too hot under here. Let me take this mask off.
Take a break, bro.
Oh, okay. That's better. That's so much better. All right. Hold on,
yeah,
guys.
You gotta go, Pete. We need Gene. Oh, there we go. We need Frank.
Oh,
can we vote? I'll take Pete back.
Yeah, me too.
Well done.
Me too.
Well done.
Just getting ready for Halloween, guys. You know,
getting ready for Halloween.
Little trick or treat.
Wow.
So well you guys done. Doing good this week?
Yeah.
Doing good.
Excellent. Excellent. All right. Me too. Surviving the winds and everything else. It's been crazy out here.
Yeah.
So.
We haven't really gotten it.
No, lucky for you.
Same here. Nothing really big out here, but we're all tucked in down a cul-de-sac and. Yeah.
Very good. Well, let's jump right into this, guys. I had a mail call.
And, all right.
Of course, one of them, and you guys have seen, if you follow us on Facebook, you know the Nobility, the band that I'm actually representing and presenting this this episode. They sent me this cool red vinyl 45.
So beautiful.
It is. It is. It's got their single on there, Rolling in the Aisle. And I want to give them a shout out because along with it, they sent me another 45.
What?
Yep. It's got Wonderful Night, and it looks like it is. I haven't opened this up yet. It looks like it is orange vinyl.
Nice.
See? Ooh-wee. So, but wait, there's more.
Oh my goodness!
Yeah, they also sent me a couple CDs of theirs.
Nice. Right? What the heck?
Yeah. And I did. I purchased the 45, and then I got all this other cool swag. So these guys are super cool, and I think you'll like the song. Really, really catchy song. But also our friend Tony Montana, Shadow and the Thrill has a CD finally out of Sugar Bowl, and of course we've interviewed Tony before and. This one happens to be signed by himself and Brent.
I was just going to say, is that an autograph?
Yes, it sure is. And he sent me a nice note. Basically, you know, thanks for supporting and we need to hang out. So thank you.
Thank you, Tony.
Yep.
Thank you.
Love it.
Thanks, Anthony.
Very good. And cool. Cool, the Nobility, man.
Oh, yeah.
Very cool.
Yep.
Yeah. Two 45s, Jim, and two different colors. Woo-wee. Yeah.
That's
good week
and
for
a couple
Frank.
CDs. I mean,
yeah.
Right away, let's find out this week what's in Jim's fridge.
What's in Jim's fridge? Here we go.
Oh, I love Jim's fridge.
I got this cold.
Sounds like it.
I'll put a graphic over that.
So we have an interesting single this week.
All right.
I don't know if you can see that.
I can't control myself.
Sunset Bombers.
All right.
Are you guys familiar with the Sunset Bombers? LA band.
No, tell us.
The guy who turned me on to this was our buddy Minnie Mendez.
Very good.
Oh, Minnie. What's up, Minnie?
And this I Can't Control Myself. That's cover of the Trogs tune.
All right.
This features on bass guitar and vocals, one Doug Figer.
Oh, the Knack.
So pre-Knack tunage there from Doug.
That's right. He was.
What year did that come out?
Mid-70s. Yeah. Pre-Knack. So Knack was what?
78?
79.
Yeah.
79. So 77, I want to say, something
cool.
like that.
Wow. Same again.
I think I found the album somewhere too, but it was easier to hunt down the 45. But
yeah,
right. Shortly after Minnie told me about that story, I ran across the 45. It's kind of an odd.
Cool. And have you given it a listen?
Oh yeah,
Now
that's cool. It's fairly
un-Knack-ish.
No, well, I was gonna say it's fairly true to the trogs. I mean, okay, it's that vibe. So.
I want to tell you guys, I've been talking to our friend Jeff Bredeman, and I went out and I picked up a couple of albums that he was on, the White Glove Test we've talked
about. Yeah,
still love that. I've been talking to him here and there, and I'm going to have him back on the show as soon as he's got some time, because this guy has got more music out there than every time he talks to me. Oh, check this out. Hey, yeah, check this out.
And currently in the studio.
Mm-hmm. In the studio.
See the studio shots, guys? I love it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Such an interesting character. So
yeah.
I just messaged him a little while ago, and then we'll see if he'll come on and kind of give us a rundown. I told him, dude, you're like an onion. Every time I turn around, there's another layer.
Something else
and another
goes layer. On, I know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Love it.
Yeah.
So
cool. So, cool.
Jeff,
yeah.
You need to come back on the show. Anyways, what about you, Jerry? You got anything going on besides that coughing and hacking and everyone seems to have?
No. No, no. Fires have missed us. The winds missed us. But, you know, you take a drive and you go anywhere 5 miles, you can see everything blowing away.
Yes.
Yeah. Heavy winds, heavy fires.
Yeah.
I don't smell anything here yet. We're good. Skies are clear.
Good.
I guess the wind's blowing the other way.
Well, you know.
But, yeah, nothing new to report, folks.
Yeah, we're lucky.
There in conspiracy land, yeah.
We've got the winds, but I don't have the fires. So.
Oh, yeah. Boy,
everybody be safe out there.
Yeah.
Right after Jim posted that he went to Rhino Records and picked up the new Stray Cats album, which was pretty sharp, I have to say.
Yeah.
Saturday, Cindy and I drove out there, and Claremont was basically packed because it was a annual fall.
Oh, you didn't go Saturday, did you?
Yeah, yeah.
Is that what you said, Saturday? Yeah.
Yeah, I went Saturday.
Good place to avoid.
Well, we went to check stuff out for the holidays and everything anyway. So
sure.
Ran into Rhino and didn't really see anything that I had to have. But they were actually unloading a bunch of videotapes and cassettes and different things outside as well. So always a good place to get a deal. So check them out.
That's a great shot.
Yeah, Rhino's great. Love it.
Yeah.
Great store and cool people.
Yes.
Yeah.
All right, guys, I tell you what.
Hold on.
You got something else for us?
Go, Jaime, go.
Oh, that's right. This was the mail call the other day.
Right. Well, this wasn't mail. This was pick this up at Burger Records.
Oh.
And this is actually a Burger Records release. Burger's out in Fullerton.
Okay.
And
it was that other band we were talking about. That you
It's the Pandora's 6-song, 12-inch EP.
Mm-hmm.
Very great, which I'm in the process of burning right now.
Cool.
The aforementioned.
Love that.
Stray Cats. So let's just.
We're getting old when the Stray Cats are at 40 years, folks. I mean, everybody else we know is 50.
Yeah. Yes.
So I was waiting to open this.
Stray Cats are at 40 now, guys.
Yeah. Hey, while Jim's doing that, you know, this is. Next episode's going to be our anniversary, guys.
Anniversary.
Yeah, we're at episode 26 right now. And next episode will be one full year, a little over.
Mm-hmm.
Gotta figure out maybe if we're going to do something special for that episode.
Yeah. So Gatefold Sleet, I won't open that up.
Okay.
It's,
sweet.
My gosh, that's pretty.
Blue and pink splatter.
Let's love it.
Wow.
Light on it there.
Oh yeah, now you see it.
Very good. Ooh. Nice.
Beautiful stuff. And then we had it comes with a poster too. Very cool. And then we had I did have mail call the other day.
Yes.
I posted up the package. Asked everybody what they thought. Nobody ventured any guesses other than Jeff.
I did.
Yes, pink.
Yeah, Barry Manilow's greatest hits on 180 grand
picture
vinyl.
Disc. Yeah,
pink vinyl. Yeah.
Nope, the Muffs.
Ah, I should have guessed that. Well done, Jim.
Yeah. Gatefold also. And this one I'm actually.
Wow.
Spared any expense these days.
Our first taste of the
special release, right? Because I knew this was going to be sort of post post Kim's passing.
Yeah.
And so, I was much better at this when I was 14.
Well, you probably had a fingernail.
Well, no, you're just getting the use of your hands back, dude.
That's part of it. Oh, so both great, of them. Great inside sleeve.
Oh, nice.
That's always nice. Yeah.
Picture there. And side four, it's three sides, and then side four is. Hopefully, you can see it on there.
You got your money's worth, Jim, out of that. Ooh. Yeah, very nice. Ooh, I can see it.
Etched vinyl.
Etched vinyl. Love it. Yep.
And it's a etching of the band on there. So
that's cool.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Well done, Jaime. Well done.
So, Jerry, the challenge is next time you got to have a mail call. Somehow.
Yeah.
Well, I'll just go into my box set.
Whatever.
That's all the vinyl I have, folks. That's the only vinyl I have. You know what? I could pop open the 45.
You can
box
45.
There you go. There you go.
You own some CDs or something?
Yeah, but I forget where they are.
But you do everything on Apple Music now, right?
I'm pretty much digital. But you know when I got married and stuff, guys, all my CD, everything went into a storage bin out in the garage.
That sounds 50-50. Yeah.
All I have left, folks, out there in conspiracy land is my pride and my digital.
Yeah.
Don't tell Laura. Yeah. Don't say nothing.
Hey, I won't say a word.
Do you know which bin your pride is in?
The bin that isn't here anymore.
Yes.
But I love her to death. She's good for me. But no, I do everything digital, Jaime. Everything. It's just, I pretty much have everything on doubles.
If
I have a CD or cassette, I guarantee you I probably have it on digital also. Yeah. So a lot of repeats. But, I don't listen to music like I used to.
Just signed up for Apple Music.
I've been pondering that.
Went ahead and did it. You can listen to everything they have. You don't have to download it. You can just listen to it.
Right.
And I'm spending more than $9.99 a month on stuff anyways. So
Apple Music, what, $3.99 a month?
It's $9.99, I think, for everything.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Because I'm doing $2.99 a month on cloud storage.
Right. Well, I'm not,
as we speak. So
I'm not planning on downloading it because I'm still going to buy vinyl.
Right.
But all the obscure stuff that they do have, if there's much, I can listen to it at least.
Yeah.
And get an idea.
$10 a month ain't bad. Is there anything you've tried to look for they don't have yet? That's my thing.
There's lots of things because they don't have every band's complete collection. If it's out of print, they don't seem to have it. It's just the popular stuff. So,
okay.
But this way, and what I've been doing is kind of listening to music outside my wheelhouse a little bit. I'm not just stuck in the metal genre or something like that. Been listening to different things and I'm not paying for it, so I don't feel like I'm losing anything. If I don't like it, turn it off, go on to something.
Move on to the next, right?
Yeah. Right.
So
right.
On to the next. Yeah.
All right, guys. We have three. I think we kind of all kind of picked pretty good poppy, peppy music this week, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you what, Jerry, why don't you go ahead and go first?
Okay.
We'll give you the floor.
Okay. Thank you, Frank. Thank you, Jaime. The band I got this week is Vicious Animals out of Atlanta, Georgia. They've got a lot of stuff out there, but their newest album is coming out November 1st, so next week. It's not available yet, but you can listen to all their stuff on Bandcamp, Facebook, SoundCloud, Twitter, Instagram. What we have here is like a solo guy, Dylan Fellows, but he wants to be called like Vicious Animals. He wants to be called Vish, V-I-S-C. So yeah, cool. The bio states, delves into topics seldom mentioned in music like morality. It looks at what makes a human different from the rest of the animal kingdom, if at all. Songs mostly critique topics like tribalism and aggression. It's good stuff, folks. I'm just reading the bio. What I like about this most, folks, and Jaime and Frank, you know this. Songs written, recorded, mixed and mastered by Dylan Fellows. I love it when it's all in-house, done by himself. We've got additional vocals by Luke Stapleton and Emily Fellows. Virtual Friends was their first album, came out in 2012. There's lots of stuff, but it's singles, little mini EPs. We've got Virtual Friends from January 2012, singles from September 2012, the original Rebels, September 2013. We've got a two-song EP, Era of the Feral and Seasons, from November of 2014. We've got Hello Disaster and Phantasmagoria from March 2017, June 2017. Drowning in Red from January 2018. We're leading up to now, folks. Daughter of America, May of 2018. Never Want to Dance, one song, from July 2018. And Merciless from August of 2018. Vicious Animals, this album will be out. You can pre-order it on Bandcamp now. It comes out November 1st. Wonderful vocals, great production, great songwriting, great lyrics. The song Frank's going to play is Vicious Animals by The Vicious Animals. So thank you, Dylan, very much for doing what you do. Again, it's Vicious Animals out of Atlanta, Georgia. And the song is Vicious Animals. So take it away, Frank. Thank you.
Here we go.
Welcome, my friend.
Vicious Animals with Vicious Animals.
I love that. Thank you, Dylan. I love that. Thank you, Vish.
Yeah. Vish.
No, that's what it says. I love it. Yeah, V-I-S-C. So do I say Visk?
Yeah,
Vish. Or do I say Vicious because we know it's short for Vicious? I say Vish. I agree, Frank.
Yeah. I like Vish.
But great vocals, great tunage.
Good production.
Mm.
Catchy, very catchy stuff. Yes. A little nod to Buddy Holly.
Buddy Holly, man.
Absolutely.
Love it.
Thank you, Frank.
Yep. Love that.
Yes.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like all the people that do the do-it-yourself musicians.
I agree 100%.
Yeah. You know, it's a labor of love, and it pays off because songs like this and some of the other ones that I've listened to, it's good stuff. Really good.
Good stuff. Vicious Animals, Atlanta, Georgia, folks. Yeah.
Check them out. Mm. All right. What'd you think about that, Jim?
Liked it. Not what I expected.
Yeah, the name kind of throws you off a little bit.
The name kind of threw me off a little bit. I was expecting something a little more hardcore, something along those lines. But I really like that. Yeah. Kind of a little rockabilly feel going on in there. I loved the little tip of the hat to Buddy Holly there, so to speak. And great tune. I'm going to go back and check out more of that.
Yeah, that's what it's all about. Good stuff.
Something I'd listen to on the way to work.
So. Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right. Well, guys, what I have this episode 26, right before the anniversary episode, Mm-hmm. I'll bring to you guys a band called the Nobility. They used to be called Jetpack back in 2001. They're out of Nashville, Tennessee. It was hard to kind of categorize this music because, again, out of my wheelhouse. It's a little happy, peppy stuff. The vocals, the production, all the stuff they sent that I listened to just blew me away, how talented these guys are. But we've got Sean Williams on lead vocals and rhythm guitar, Stephen Jerkins on background vocals and keyboards, Cheyenne Metters is background vocals and bass, and Will Metters on background vocals and drums. And their bio says on certain performances, the third Metter brother, Carson, plays lead guitar. So going to their Bandcamp page, there's not a whole lot on them. Their music speaks for themselves. They're just a talented bunch of musicians. And the song that I'm going to play for you is called Rollin' in the Aisle. And you guys tell me how you would categorize this after we give it a listen.
I interject just before you do that, Frank?
You may.
If you don't mind, Jaime, did you notice Frank didn't mangle one of those names? Not one.
Yeah. Well,
thank you guys.
Yeah.
Thank you, Nobility.
Yes.
For having easy names for Frank to pronounce.
Well done, Frank.
I appreciate it.
Sorry, Frank.
No, it's true.
I'm gonna wait till we get to my turn.
Uh-oh. Okay.
Let's give the Nobility a listen. It's a taste of the Nobility with Rollin' in the Aisle.
Who are you and what have you done with Frank Trigado?
Is that not some catchy stuff or what? You know, I'm finding that a band like this, and again, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 other releases they've put out over the years. Check them all out on Bandcamp. They're on iTunes, Apple Music. They're all different, but yet the same. But what I'm finding is I am just so thrilled when I can find a band with a lead singer who can hold a note. Because
well, that's Frank's thing, folks. Yeah. No auto tune, no jibber jabber.
No.
Can you effing sing if you're a singer?
Just good sound and stuff. I love the background because backing vocals changed up. You know, we've got different things going on. Guitars come in and it's just layers upon layers, but yet it's simple.
Yeah, that was good.
You know,
that was good. Yeah.
Really enjoyed it. Mm-hmm. What'd you say, Jerry?
I liked it.
You liked it?
Yeah, a little Carsy, but I like it. A little bit like the Cars. I like it. I like it a lot.
Yeah.
I like that keyboard. I like it's a kind of a raw recording. I like that too. Mm-hmm. But I always love songs that, you know, where the keyboard maybe follows the vocalist or the vocalist takes a pause and then the keyboard kind of follows it.
Yeah.
I like it.
Right.
I like it a lot. Yeah. The Nobility. I like it.
And what say you, Jim?
A little bit out of my wheelhouse too. Mm-hmm. It was kind of synth poppy, and then when it got to the chorus, it became sort of a disco song. And I love that bass line in the background, kind of driving it. Yeah. Thought that was great. Very interesting. Surprising from you. When you said, it's out of my wheelhouse, I'm like thinking, so it doesn't sound like Venom this way.
Right, yeah. Okay. When I first got the music, I played it for Cindy like I normally do, give her kind of a first taste of what's going on. And her first thing was, man, you know what? That intro is too long. That's half the song. You gotta find a song that has, you know, that jumps right into it. And I said, no, I'm going to keep the intro only because it builds. This is one of those songs. It's got a good build to it.
Yeah.
But, that was her first impression is, hey, you know, it's taking a little longer for the amount of time you guys give these songs, you know, they're not going to get their full taste of it.
Right.
Well, you know what? Go out and buy this stuff and you can taste it all you
want.
That's it. Yeah. So that's Nobility. Check them out. They are well deserving of your ears. Trust me.
Yeah, that's good. That's good, Frank.
Mm-hmm. All right. So let's move on to Mr. Jim Strong.
I'm here.
So the band I have this week is the Walker Brigade, and I first learned about this band, I don't even know how long ago. We were strangely in Chinatown, and we were, gallery hopping down there one night, and, they had a few bands along the Chungking Road there. And, you know, everything was just kind of okay. And then I was in one gallery, and then I could hear the band playing down at the end of the block there. Oh. And it just caught my ears right off the bat. And I thought, like, wow, there's like a guy and a woman and a man singing. It's got kind of an X vibe to it. I'm like, this is great. So I immediately kind of ran out of the gallery and ran down the street.
Yeah, you did.
Yeah, I did. Watched them play like the next few songs. And I was just blown away with how great they were.
Wow.
And they finished their set, and I professed my love to them. and I think it was their guitar player, Jeff, was kind enough to hand me their EP. And I took it home and listened to it and just loved it. Great original songs. Mm. And a great great cover of Soft Boys, I Want to Destroy You, on there.
Cool.
And so this is kind of the little blurb off the Big Stir Records thing. And but I think I'll read this because it kind of captures exactly what I heard that night. Equal parts art, punk, and pop, the band caught our ears with their early demos, mixing fine originals in the vein of X and the Pixies with covers of Wire, Only Ones, Ramones, and Soft Boys tunes. They released their first album in 2017. Therapy Animal. And so... This is available as a digital single on Big Stir Records, recorded with Karen Bassett of the Pandoras. She recorded them at her studio.
Wow.
And so what we won't have with this is any waiting for the song to pick up, because the song bursts into action.
Gets to it, huh?
Gets to it right from the get-go. So now what I didn't do was... What I didn't do was ask Jeff for a pronunciation guide. So we're going to get what we get here. Tracy Rose Keaton, vocals and guitar.
Check.
Jeff Charot, guitar and vocals.
Check.
Mark Fletcher, bass and acoustic guitar. And check. Craig Tyrka, drums and percussion.
maybe not.
Yeah, I know. Blew it up there a little bit. Anyway, I've been a fan of these guys for... been a fan of these guys for a while. They're also currently in the studio with Karen recording their next album. So looking forward to when the full length comes out. This song's called Tower. And when you buy it, you get the B-side, which is I'm Tired, which, if you remember, was the song from Is it Young Frankenstein? One that burned Peters. Yes.
Time.
So it's a cover of that, right? It's very
cool. I'm so tired. Right.
So let's go ahead and hear it.
Let's give it a listen. Any stories in alibi taller than any nation's tower to the sky.
Your gripping hands, I rose to take a chance. I stole hell and heaven for you. Smile so fake, but breath so real. Hair like silk to feel. Frightened by your funhouse mind, I don't mind. Jokers wild, so we're a pair. I would kill for you, and you know I'd die for you. I don't care. Turned us on, kept us off to dark. Burning clean and goddess rain alchemy. Tracing time can be a drone. Choose a media. Nothing is impossible when we're alone. You hate it slow. Go as fast as I can go. Don't you know? Adding stories and alibi.
I totally get your X analogy, Jim.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Yeah, good stuff.
That's all over the place.
Love that chorus.
Yep.
Yeah.
Very good. I not what I was expecting. You know.
No.
Yeah. I gave it a quick listen before the show, and I didn't listen all the way through, and it kind of takes off in a different direction after it gets going.
Yes.
Too. Very, very good. I like that.
Well done, Jim.
Yes. Wow.
Good stuff.
So they were put together about 2017, or is that their first album?
No, ahead of 2017. So they had been playing around and then recorded their first album in 2017. I'm not even sure what year it was when I saw them. It had to be a good 5-6 years ago, I'm thinking.
Well, when's the last time you were at the gallery, James?
It's been a while.
Yep. Okay. So
I love the fact that you could be doing that, Jim, and just hear some music down the street and go see what it is. And just, that's the way it should be done, folks.
Yeah, well, evidently it was a big opening that night. We didn't know we ended up there by accident, but
that's how it should be.
They had a band at one end, they had a band at another end, they had a band kind of in the middle. But
All
of them, the Walker Brigade, like, just kicked butt and, like I said, fell in love with them right then.
Awesome.
There.
Yeah, that never happened.
Great mix of pop and punk and.
Really everything. I said,
yeah.
That never happens to me. I mean, I can come out of a store and find a taco truck, but I never find a band playing good music.
Taco trucks are always welcome.
Yeah.
Yes. Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
I like taco trucks and I like great music.
There you go.
Two great tastes that taste great together.
That's right.
Well done, Jaime.
Yes. Wow. Very nice. Very nice.
Boy, that gym is smooth, folks.
Mm-mm. That's Tower in the Walker Brigade.
That's the name
of the band. Good stuff. Check them out, folks. You must check them out.
And check out Big Stir Records. A lot of great acts on there.
Yeah. Very good. I love it. Well,
I do too. That's good.
This episode was my pick for a classic album. And I went with the Knack.
Classic.
Yeah. Again, throwing Jim and I a curveball. I don't know about you, Jaime, but that was a curveball from Frank picking this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like the album, Get the Knack. You know, like we said, it came out, 79? Is that what we decided?
That's what we figured, yeah.
79.
Ahead of our junior year.
End of our sophomore year. That's right, Jaime. Yep. Summer before our junior year. Woo-wee. Yeah,
that's it.
We just started driving. Wow.
I probably had the cassette.
Terrorizing the community.
Mm-hmm. Maybe I took out a mailbox or two. I'm not sure.
But, yeah, or two.
Shocking.
Yep. But when the Knack came out, again, not music I was listening to, but you know, My Sharona was such a massive hit. Wow. And it got so much airplay.
All summer long.
Yeah.
I was not a fan.
Yeah.
I was not a fan of My Sharona. It wasn't until I heard other songs that I enjoyed the band. Mm.
I didn't jump on the train right away, but you couldn't help it because they were on the radio so much.
Mm-hmm. You
know? But reading up on them, when you put out an album and people like Tom Petty and Bruce Springsteen are singing your praises, you're in pretty good shape.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Probably. Yeah.
Wow.
But I don't listen to those guys.
Neither do I, except Damn the Torpedoes.
But you know what?
With a 12-string Rickenbacker on the cover.
On the cover.
Yeah. In 1979, you know, that's, you know, who ruled the airwaves, you know, when you think about
absolutely.
It.
Absolutely.
So, sure. And again, Van produced Halen. By Mike Chapman.
Mike yes. Chapman.
Been around with everybody.
Yeah.
Blondie and... how many songs did he write for the suite? Instrumental. Yeah. So, but anyways, we're going to give side one a listen to, and it starts out with Let Me Out. And then your number or your name comes up after that. Oh, Tara. Love that song. She's So Selfish. Another one I like.
My favorite.
Maybe Tonight. And then Good Girls Don't ends up the last song you're going to hear from side one. And we'll talk about that in just a second.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody plays her game. She got the style and the class, and she get what she wants. And everybody knows her name. She got the smile and the ass and the power to flaunt. Cause she really in it just for herself. No, she doesn't care for nobody else. It's just me, 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 me. She's so time is heard she's pretty fast, and you're hoping that she'll give you some tonight. So you start to make your play, 'cause you could have swore you thought you heard her saying, good girls don't, good girls don't. But she'd be telling you, good girls don't, but I do. And it's a teenage.
All right, that's side one of the Knack. Yeah. Get the Knack. And right off the bat, you get why there was Beatles comparisons.
Oh, yeah.
Harmonies, guitars.
Outside of just the way they looked.
Yeah.
To me, Jaime, you're exactly right on that. I think I saw the – if you look at the front of the cover, you don't see that. If you look at the back of the album cover, they're set up like Beatles.
Well, that was – that was.
But I never – in other words, I think I saw the back of the cover first that made me think Beatles. I didn't think Beatles by hearing it.
No, okay.
I think I thought I saw the cover and then got into it. Because to me, the exchange between Doug Figger and Bert Navarro, just the great rhythm, great lead. Oh,
well, they,
great album.
I definitely hear Beatles influence.
Yeah, they definitely planned. The front of the album is a take on the Beatles, Meet the Beatles.
Meet the Beatles, right?
And the back of it.
Oh, it is.
Yes,
oh, okay.
And the back of it is an homage to A Hard Day's Night, because there's a scene in the movie when they're in the studio playing.
Right.
And that's where
right,
they took that
Frank.
From.
That's okay. That's when I first
completely
thought it was
planned.
The back cover.
Yep. Yes. Completely planned. And but when you listen to that first song, Let Me Out, close your eyes for just a second. In another universe, could you not hear Robin Zander singing that song?
Yes.
Absolutely.
God. Yes. I thought the exact same thing when I heard it.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah.
I thought, man, this is cheap. This is a cheap trick tune.
Yes. All the way. Now, not so much the rest of the first side, but
no.
I do get the, you know, the Beatles comparisons by, like I say, the guitars and the way the song. These guys did a lot of negative space in their songs, meaning there's more stops, and where the music isn't is just as important as where the music is.
Very
good. Great sound crafting is, the song crafting
I like
is just
it.
Amazing.
That's a great album. Yeah.
Well, side two comes in with My Sharona. The big hit
all summer long, folks.
Oh, yeah.
Heard it all summer long,
and then it goes into Heartbeat, Siamese Twins, Lucinda,
The Monkey and Me.
Yeah, That's What the Little Girls Do, and a lot of innuendos in this album, and then it ends up with Frustrated, and it has to do with all those girls, I'm sure.
And that's a lack of innuendo.
Yes, it is. So, let's give side two a listen. Jazz Side 2,
mm-hmm.
Get the Knack. Pretty solid debut album, would you say?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
My gosh.
Yeah, solid. The playing on it is great.
Yeah.
You know, one thing I really enjoyed going back and listening to this was just listening to the bass parts in it.
Well, of course.
And, bass. Oh, all
yeah,
the way through.
Yeah.
Clean. Jim noticed the bass. Oh, yeah. Clean as heck. Prescott Niles.
Yep.
Yes. But the drumming.
Bruce Gary.
Is just, everything is so well placed on this record. Yeah. I mean, every song is so, well produced, well thought out.
Yeah.
The arrangements are just, you can't really fault it.
No.
Great debut.
It's just very solid.
Yes.
If I was gonna gripe about anything, and I will.
Yes.
Well, yeah.
I would have picked either She's So Selfish or Frustrated, but not both.
Mm-hmm.
I would have left one on the album. The album gets a little long for me.
Okay.
But I have a short attention span.
Yeah.
So mm-hmm. There you go.
He said it, folks, not Frank or I.
Well, I mean, they're kind of the same song, just different.
They're interchangeable.
Exact same topic. So yeah. It was just kind of like, okay, we've kind of been there on the album. We don't need to do it again.
Hey, I want to ask you guys, does the name Hugh Brown ring a bell with either one of you?
Hugh?
I bet
Hugh
it
Brown.
Should. Knowing you, Frank, I bet it should.
He's the fine gentleman that designed the Clash's Give Him Enough Rope album cover. And he started Nuke the Knack.
Ah.
Yeah.
That's the one.
That was a whole movement, guys.
It was a whole movement. Mm-hmm. I remember people wearing buttons. Nuke the Knack.
I've never seen stickers like that, Jaime.
Yep.
Stickers that said that. Yeah.
I'm not really sure what that, I'm not sure if that was a, people were just sick of hearing them by the end of that year or.
I know I was.
I really think it was kind of a slap in their face of the style of music that was becoming so popular right then, you know, because punk was kind of had its phase. And I think, you know, they didn't like the cleanness of it, even though the song
is very clean.
It's
a power pop masterpiece.
Yes. Yes.
Absolutely.
Hey, I just want to make mention right now. This is the first time I've been doing this whole podcast with our music up front, so I haven't been able to see. But Jim, I only have half your head. Your camera is super low, so we're gonna get your eyeballs in your nose.
I don't
in this
see his
episode.
Mouth. Yeah, all I see is his nose.
I can see me fine, so I'm not really sure what's up.
Okay, we'll see how that comes out.
Oh no, it is a little low. There we go.
You do have a torso. Okay,
and he's wearing a Superman shirt, yes. Frank.
Little lower, maybe, but that's okay.
Yeah. There we go.
Yeah. But yeah, better.
Not touching that one.
No.
No comments.
Does that album stand the test of time, guys? What do you think?
Hell yeah.
Yes.
Yeah?
Not even close.
What's your favorite song, Jerry?
She's So Selfish.
You like that one, huh?
Yes. Yeah. Yes, and Frustrated. Yeah, I like them all. I'm tired of... What I like about this, it's like a good old-fashioned Kiss album. Every song has a great lead guitar riff in it. And Bert Nevaire, lead guitar for the Knack, is no slouch by any means. These lead licks are fantastic throughout the album.
Yep. Well, I liked it because it's a very clean sounding album. And then you see, like, say a solo super comes clean. In and it's in your face. You know, it's not super distorted or anything, but you get every
very
note.
Very clean.
Yeah.
Very clean.
Yep.
And Doug is no slouch on rhythm guitar either.
No.
To me, there's nothing better, folks, out in conspiracy land when somebody cuts off into a lead and that rhythm guitar just keeps you in the mix. Up. And let the guy go where he wants with that lead, but that rhythm's keeping you right here. We're right here, folks. We're right here. And this album is just chock full of great leads, great rhythm, great everything. Like Jim says, bass. Fantastic bass by Prescott Niles throughout. Bruce Gary on the drums.
Good
holds
stuff.
Up. Holds up.
Yes. I'm glad I picked it for you, Jerry. Now,
that was a mind blower that you picked it, but then it wasn't a mind blower that. Yeah. No, but then he had it on colored vinyl, Jim, which is not
I know. Awesome. Yeah. That was awesome.
And you know, speak of that, when the original album came out, it was in the Knack contract that they had the rainbow label, just like the Beatles did from Capitol Records. It was actually put in their contract that their albums came out. They wanted to be so much like the Beatles that it was ridiculous.
So, wow.
But in the colored vinyl that I have, it's the same colored rainbow label. Just love it.
As it should be.
Yep. Now, exactly. Now, Jim, did you have a favorite on that?
So my favorite tune is Your Number or Your Name.
Okay. That's a good one.
Yeah. I just love how smooth that song is.
Yeah.
It's kind of tough to pick a favorite, but that's kind of it. Oterra, it's such a contrast because he sings in that song about, you know, the thrill of holding her hand or something like that, right? And as opposed to singing about going down on some girl in,
Way down there.
Yeah, no, it is. It's a bit all over the place. But I like Let Me Out. 2 minutes, 20 seconds. Good way to start an album.
Yeah, it's a great, great hard-hitting song. And I love that. Yeah. I love that song, too. But kind of a toss-up between that and the Your Number or Your Name. But.
Gotcha. Very good. Well, I think it stands test time. I think you guys are right.
It absolutely does.
It's
their second album doesn't.
I can't tell you any songs on the second album. I didn't get it.
I could because I bought it.
I'm sure you did. You were the guy.
I have all the Knack. I have all Knack digital. All of it. All of it.
How many albums did they put out?
Oh, I want it. Just off the top of my head, I'm going to say 7 or 8. Oh, no, Jim. They got way crazier. They had the drummer from, an album called Zoom and Normal Is the Next Guy, and I've got a lot of Knack digital. Yeah, a lot of it.
Did not know that.
They stayed true. They stayed true. Bruce Gary got sick and passed away, but he left the band first. So the first albums have the entire lineup, and then after that, it goes guest drummer.
Right.
Gosh, I wish I could think of the drummer they had on Zoom.
I want to say it is...
He was a drummer from some other band.
Bozio.
Huh?
Terry Bozio, I think.
He did. Oh. He did drum on an album. That's right.
Terry's an awesome drummer.
Yes.
Yeah. He drummed with Zappa for a long time.
Oh, yeah. Excellent. That's Normal Is the Next Guy or Zoom. Yeah. But anyway.
Before we get into Jim's pick, I want to ask you guys really quick. A few episodes ago, I asked you about a couple of bands, and one of them you got to ditch, right? Now, recently in the news, Aerosmith and The Who both had to cancel shows because their lead singers, all both in their 70s, had vocal issues. So, Jim, which of those two bands could you give up and never listen to again? The Who or Aerosmith?
Dude, come on. Yeah. That's not fair.
I love them both, but easy pick for me.
Yeah, me too.
And one of them has a new album coming out within a couple of weeks. And one of the bands has all their original members, and one of the bands has half their original members due to mortality.
Yeah.
Boy, I'm going to say if I had to give up one. Today it's Aerosmith.
Jerry?
Next week, it'll probably be The Who.
Now, although Draw the Line is my favorite Aerosmith album by far, everybody can say anything they want. Oh, they're all on drugs. They're all on. The Line is the best Aerosmith album ever. But if I'm going to give one up, I'm giving up Aerosmith.
Yeah.
I will take The Who any day of the week.
You know, I am right there with you. I love Aerosmith. They've got a lot of good music.
No downer on Aerosmith.
The depth and the catalog of The Who, just overpowered. I'd rather listen to their music in the long haul than Aerosmith. If I had to give one of them up, I'd give up Aerosmith. If I never hear Dream On again, I don't think my life would change one way.
I agree 100%, but don't ever get rid of the album Draw the Line.
See, I like...
I love it.
Night in the Ruts. I liked all their obscure
Night
albums.
Night in the Ruts is good, too.
You know,
is up that until, the first album? Was Joe Perry with them on that one?
Night
or is that
Ruts,
the first one
no.
they did without Joe?
No, that was without Joe. That was with Jimmy Crespo. And,
Crespo.
And,
I don't know. It's hard to beat the first four Aerosmith albums.
Yes, they're awesome.
Good point, Jim. Very yep. good. Yep.
So you're just not going to pick, huh, Jim? You're just going to play that?
No,
on...
I said.
You said he'd give up Aerosmith.
Okay. I'd give up Aerosmith. I'd take the
Who. Well, what about
I
you
said
people?
This week.
This week.
This week.
Right. Okay. Good point, Jim. Very good point. Also, this week.
Yeah. Who sell out?
I'm curious what our listeners would think.
To me, it's the Who by Numbers and Quadrophenia.
Oh, yeah. Tommy. Tommy for me. I love that
album.
Oh,
for sure. For sure.
So, anyways, our next episode, which will be our one-year anniversary show... And Jim gets the pick, right? Yeah. There he goes. The number of the beast.
The number of the beast.
You've been holding out because
he's... I'm in. Yes.
Such a
yes.
good album.
It was really a toss-up between this and the debut, but I think people are probably a little more familiar with Number of the Beast.
Yes.
So.
Very wow. nice. I love the first two albums. I liked the punk rawness of them. But
yes.
But when Bruce Dickinson came on board, holy mackerel, the whole dynamic of the band changed.
Yeah, absolutely, wow. didn't it?
Well, yeah. I prefer, as far as like live, mm-hmm. I kind of prefer Paul.
Well, I love the rawness of the band at that point.
But on album, I think I prefer Bruce Dickinson.
Yes, so. Very good. Now, I'm up to, I think I posted this on our Facebook page, up to, I don't know, Seventh Son of a Seventh Son, or I forget which album it is. I don't care for any of their newer stuff at all. No Prayer for the Dying and all that. I people will hate on me all they want. It's the same album over.
Don't they have like
over
a,
and over?
They have like 30 live albums out or something.
Yeah, they're one of those bands. That's what they do. You know, they get an itch and they put a live album out. So not a fan because it's the same songs, or they'll do two or three from the old days and it'll all be the newer albums. And there's just no hook to me on those.
Well, they went from doing like 3, 4, 5 minute songs to doing 12 minute songs. Yeah. You know how I am with that stuff.
Oh yeah.
And it's just kind of repeating the same riff over and over again, yeah. and then they go back into the other riff, and it's like.
Right. And then the third time he plays it, maybe I can play this lead better this time.
Well, if you're not moving the song forward, I don't see any point in it.
Agreed.
Did you see the clip online of their guitarist flipping his Strat and just throwing it? He was putting it around his neck, flew out into the audience.
No.
Look it up.
Janik.
Ouch.
Yeah.
Ouch.
I believe his name is Janik Gers. Yeah. How you pronounce his name?
Janik Gers.
He was Bruce Dickinson's guitarist when he did solo.
Yeah.
And he dances around all the time, but he always throws his guitar around his neck, but... This one particular time, it went flying out into the audience. Just,
ouch.
To me, somebody that's like going to a baseball game. I'm keeping that foul ball. You ain't getting
that
guitar back.
Absolutely. I keep this guitar yeah, or I call my lawyer.
Uh-huh.
It's one of the two.
For near as I could tell, he was throwing it to me.
That's right. So. It was a gift.
Yeah. I don't know. Somebody commented recently about him on stage.
Yeah.
Like he just doesn't fit.
He doesn't belong.
In, right? It's like totally a...
Him and Bruce had something going on. You know, like I said, they did these two solo albums together, and I think it was part of the contract for Bruce to come back in, because they don't need three guitarists
no.
on that band, because oh. you know, they are talented as it is. So then you throw him in there, and they do give him leads. You know, when you're doing 12-minute songs, you can get a lead break for the third guy if you want. And
sure.
Yeah, you know, and the Make a Wish kid in the first row. Yeah,
kind of sounds like Yoko to me.
Yeah. He's allowed to be there because.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I like this guy. He inspires me.
Yeah,
can he join the band? No, Bruce.
I really think that's the deal. Is with no Janik, no Bruce. You know that you're. He comes or
that,
I'm not coming
that ain't
back.
Right.
No.
That ain't
right. Don't can't say.
No, but that's what it looks like to me. From the
you
outside,
stick with your boys like we have all these years. You got to stick with your boys.
There you go.
No.
All right, guys. Well, this has been a fast-paced episode, and
yeah.
I think we hit all the things. Like I said, if you're watching us here, subscribe, follow us on Facebook, Instagram, listen
smash
to us.
Smash the like button.
Smash
it,
like
folks.
Button. Yep. And to the bands that we just put on here, that the Nobility, everybody else, I hope their fans follow us.
And, yeah, Vicious Animals and the Walker Brigade. Yes, thank you.
Absolutely. Appreciate thank the music. Yeah. Well, Jerry, if you don't have anything.
No, I'm good.
You're good.
Nice seeing you guys again.
Absolutely.
Love you guys. It's the only time I see him, folks, every 2 weeks.
Yeah, that, whose fault is that?
Well, I think it was Jim's last time. Yeah. Okay. Jim couldn't make it. And then Frank says, well, hey, Jerry, should we just do a duo show? There's no way hell Frank and I can haul this by ourselves. We got to have Jaime. Are you kidding? now, Jaime and Frank could probably run it by themselves. But I know Frank and I. Frank's like, hey, you just want to do a duo? I'm like, yeah.
Didn't want to do
Jaime.
It.
Where is Jaime?
I just want to put a product out, guys. I don't.
I understand.
I was going to ask my neighbor if he wanted to join. I don't care.
Yeah. There you go. Pretty soon it's going to be Frank and a couple of other guys.
Yeah, it's going to change. I just got to make sure the names start with J.
You like
I don't
music,
care.
Right,
there you go.
Jorge, I don't care.
Jeff and Jason.
Yep. It's all right.
Folks, I love
okay, very good.
All right, Jim, what you got for us?
Shop's closed.